Hey, welcome, Mosaic. Here's a stand with me, and let's have a word of prayer. Jesus, we just invite your presence here today. Lord, we're excited to worship you. Lord, we are a blessed people that you would love us and know us, and that you would ask that we would come to your throne of grace, Lord, boldly, and that we could worship you. Lord, we know that your God is not far off, but you're close to us and that you hear our praises. Lord, in fact, you're living inside of us. Lord, we just pray that your spirit would be here, communing with us, interacting with us, and hearing our praises. Lord, pouring out your grace as we pour out your praise. Lord, speak to us today. Lord, may your kindness bring us to repentance. May your grace and mercy carry us through this life, Jesus. We worship you in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Hallelujah. Oh, the center, lift him high as we worship with the angels forever. You are holy, you are worthy of our praises.
Lord, we know when you're at the center of our lives, things begin to fall into place the way you intended. That when you're the object of our affection, our life on earth begins to align with heaven. That as we become more like you, more like your Son, the more you become the center of all that we revolve around, Lord. Not because you force us, Lord, by your hand, but Lord, your grace, your kindness, it brings us to you. Good Father, Jesus. You're a good Father, Lord. We love you. Holy Spirit, we love you. We lift you high in this place. We remember your mighty works, your mighty deeds. We think about the stories in our lives, Lord. You're an incredible author. Who are we to be able to sing these praises? Who are we that we could come to your feet and speak? Lord, you've allowed that to happen by the cross. We don't take it for granted. Lord, we know that we're on holy ground, not because of brick and mortar, but because of your presence. Your presence, Jesus. Soften the hearts of your people to be people who revolve around your presence. That it would spill over to the lost and broken around us. That the world would know that you are truth, that you're on the throne. You cannot be shaken. Your will cannot be deterred. You are all you say you are, Jesus.
Oh, Lord, my God, when I am lost in wonder, consider all the worlds thy hands have made. I see the stars. I hear the rolling thunder, thy power throughout the universe displayed. And sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. And when that God is Son, not sparing, sent him to die. I scarce can take it in that on the cross, my burden gladly bearing, he bled and died to take away my sin.
We respond.
Shouts of acclamation and take me home. What joy shall fill my heart? Then I shall bow in humble adoration and there proclaim, my God, how great you are.
Father, the text that goes through my mind is given. It'll be given to you, shaken together, pressed down, flowing into your lap. For the measure with which we use, it'll be used back to us. And Father, may we see that passage not as what we might receive from you, but as we engage and offer you our very best, giving with a full measure, that what we receive is what's of you. And may that be our prayer today, that you would be our treasure. And as we offer ourselves, our hearts, our minds, our attention, our engagement to you, and give it to you with the fullest measure we can offer today, press it down, shake it together, and flow it into our laps, that we would know you and see you more and more and more. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Do me a favor, shake a hand, give somebody a hug, say hello, learn a name. Good morning, everybody. Welcome to Mosaic. My name is Tony. I'm one of the guys here. If this is your first time here, thanks for being with us. If it's not your first time here, thanks for being with us. I'm very excited about the morning in terms of what I think God's got in store for us. What I'd like to do is go ahead and pray and get rolling if we can. Father, we thank you so much for the day. We thank you for the sunshine, the brisk air, the kiss on the cheek. It says good morning. And I pray, Lord, that we would enjoy the day. Whatever it is that it brings, may we find joy in it, and may we find substance in it, and may we find you in it. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Do me a favor, if you would. I need you to open your... First, I need you to grab your notes. If you'd grab your notes, the bulletin, whatever it is you have there, and there should actually be an insert in it. There's a green insert that says Fall Festival, and I want you to hold that in your hand, and then I need you to grab your Bible, and I need you to go to Mark, the Gospel of Mark, chapter 10. I was just singing disco and wearing a disco shirt all at the same time. Can you believe that? And I wouldn't even put it together until I looked down. Okay, so, and my hips were doing this because that's where I dance, right there. That's all I got. And I'm going to just stay right that in the, never mind. Okay, so here we go. Last week, what we did was, what we're going to be doing today is we're going to be looking at furthering our character, deepening our character, what it takes to begin to dig deep into our soul and our minds in terms of becoming more and more like Christ, what that looks like. It's going to get very practical today and over the course of probably the next 8 weeks, where we're just going to start digging into very practical areas of our lives and seeing what it is we need to do to continue to be transformed. But what I'd like to do is tie this in with last week. So last week we looked at a very tiny little story about Jesus. Now, I want you to, this is the yellow piece of paper. Hold this in your hand while we read this, okay? Hold that in your hand while we read that. It's not going to do anything magical. It's not going to turn into a $100 bill. Maybe a $1,000 bill. Do they make $1,000 bills? Are those real things? Aren't they? I have no idea. Well, it might turn into a $1,000 bill then and then try to use it. Okay, so here we go. Before we Before we read, I'd like to pray again. Father, we thank you for your word. Just embed it deep in our hearts, in our minds. Just transform us. Let us see you, Jesus, a perfect representation of the Father here on earth, full of your spirit, and moving, Lord God, according to the Father's will. So may we do the same and just see him for who he is and become more like him. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. So what we've been doing is doing this series on living a worthy life. And what I want us to see in this living a worthy life is how we can be more like Jesus and what that looks like in the everyday. And so last week we took a look at this tiny little picture of what I believe is one of the best synopses in the entire Bible. In terms of just a quick snapshot of the fullness of the character of Christ Jesus and what it looks like when we walk with the Holy Spirit. So we're going to start at verse, what verse am I starting on? 16, Mark 10, 16, correct? No? Silly me. Go to 13, my bad, I have a typo in my notes. Okay, so here we go. It says, people, now, for those of you who weren't here, Jesus is on his way to Jerusalem to die. That's where he's going. And another gospel says he was tired from his journey, and he sat down, and as he's sitting, people were bringing, verse 13, little children to Jesus for him to place his hands on them. And the disciples rebuked him. And we're going to give the disciples the benefit of the doubt today, and just that they were trying to protect Jesus, knowing that he was exhausted, maybe a little anxious, and there were lots of things going on. When Jesus saw this, he was indignant. He was vexed. He said to them, "Let the children come to me and do not hinder them, for the kingdom of God belongs to such as these. Truly I tell you, anyone who will not receive the kingdom of God like a little child will never enter into it." So this is Jesus' admonition to the disciples, reminding them what their hearts need to look like and needs to resemble that of a child. Not necessarily innocence, but faithfulness and trust. Look what it goes on to say now, verse 16. And in that moment, he took the children in his arms, he placed his hands on them, and he blessed them. Don't just read over that verse. That is, to me, the snapshot of the beauty of Christ Jesus. That, to me, is the snapshot of what it looks like when we walk with the Spirit in such a way as to allow it to slow our hearts and minds, to allow our days to dissipate around us, when somebody comes to engage with us and we stop and we look them in the eye and we put our hands on them, in essence, and we bless them. To me, this is the beauty of Christ Jesus right here. Now, the reason I have you holding this piece of paper is for this reason. Coming up in a couple weeks, we close our parking lot down over here and we set it up for children of the neighborhood. Now, we may not be able to, frankly, physically take them in our arms and bless them, but what we can do is engage with them in such a way as to bless them. And many of the children in this neighborhood have no opportunity to be blessed, would not know what a blessing looks like if they tripped over it. And it's a fantastic opportunity for us to express the kindness of Jesus, his character, and how the Spirit moves in us for children. So, here's my encouragement. I would encourage, first of all, that we pray, that we make sure we're praying for this event coming up. Second of all, I would ask you if you would take into consideration actually being part of this event. We have people downstairs, and there are different things that can be done and different things that we need to have done, but here's the essence of it. We have this beautiful opportunity to bless children who don't get blessed very often, to embrace them, to engage with them, and to share with them. And I would encourage us all to take that into consideration. Last year, we had almost 400 children show up for this, all from the neighborhood. Think about it. Pray about it. Do it. Awesome. Okay, that was announcement number one. Announcement number two will come later. So here we go. Ready? So turn to Ephesians with me, if you would. Turn to Ephesians. And no, that was not manipulation. Anytime, listen, if something's worthy of being announced here, it's because it's worthy of being done. If it's worthy of being done here, it means it's got a specific purpose. And that purpose always lines up with who we're trying to be. And if what we're trying to be is like Jesus, and we're trying to be a testimony to a lost world, and one of the ways Jesus demonstrated that was being still and in the moment and embracing children, then we ought to be doing the same thing. So, Take that for what it's worth. We're in Ephesians chapter 4, and we're going to start actually at verse 1 because I want us to remember where we are coming from, if we can. And then what we're going to do is we're going to have fun looking at a text. But I'm going to tell you, my teaching today is going to be a little different than it normally is. I'm going to be, I can't say that I'm not boring all the time because I don't have to listen to me. I might be boring all the time, but I'm going to be more boring today than I have been in a long time. So let's take a look at this. So verse 1, it says, as a prisoner for the Lord, this is Paul writing to the Ephesians. Actually, he's writing a letter to the many churches, and this is landing in the Ephesians' lap. As a prisoner for the Lord, then I exhort you to live a life worthy of the calling you've received. Now, we never want to forget what that means, because what that means is that our God has called us, he has saved us, he has forgiven our sins, he's embedded his character in us, his Holy Spirit is in us, and we now are his representatives. We ought to live a life that represents him then well, and that's exactly what Paul is saying. And the interesting thing about this is this, from this point forward, from this point backward in this book, and if you've not been in this series through Ephesians in the course of the last year, and which is how long it's taken us to get this far, go back and read chapters 1-3, because that is what God has done. Chapters 4 and on is what we do to join God in that work. And that's why it starts right here by saying, live a life worthy of the calling you have received, because everything from that point forward is teaching us how to live that life. And that's what we're going to look at, is some fundamental truths in that regard right now. So if we were to have gone on in chapter 4, or actually we can go to chapter 4 now, or I'm already in chapter 4. Look at that. As a prisoner, okay, so if we go down, if we just skim down here, and look what it says. As a prisoner for the Lord, then I urge you to live a life worthy of the calling you've received. He then says, be humble and gentle and patient, bearing with one another love, and make every effort to keep the unity of the Spirit through the bond of peace. Then he speaks of one body, one Father, one Spirit. Then he speaks to each one of us that we've been given the Spirit, as Christ has apportioned it. He has placed us in the body, and then he's given us teachers and pastors to equip us to do ministry, to equip us for service, and then to unite the body that we would grow into the likeness of Christ, not only individually, but as a body. So that's what leads up to this moment right here in verse 17. Now, this is what I'd like you to do. I need you to have some fun with me, okay? So I want you to, as we read this text, I want you to mentally grab, or even if you're right, you know, if you have a Bible and you write in it or you're taking notes, I want you to grab the words that jump off the page at you. I want you to look at the words that, for whatever reason, go boom, just like that. Okay, so here we go. Starting at verse 17, it says, "So I tell you this." Again, this is Paul writing, and insist on it in the Lord. In other words, he's being emphatic that you must no longer live as the Gentiles do, in the futility of their thinking. They are darkened in their understanding and separated from the life of God because of the ignorance that is in them due to the hardening of their hearts. I'm going to stop. I'm going to go back. I'm going to reread that. And again, I want you to look for words that jump off the page at you. And I don't care. And what I want you to do is kind of grab the emotion that comes with that jumping. Is it affirmation? Is it excitement? Is it questioning? Is it anger? There are words here, contempt. There are words here that can jump off and hit us right in the belly, and that the feeling we get when we see the word could be something you don't expect. I know it does for me. All right, so here we go again. So I tell you this, and insist on the Lord, that you must no longer live as the Gentiles do, in the futility of their thinking. They are darkened in their understanding and separated from the life of God because of the ignorance that is in them due to the hardening of their hearts. Having lost all sensitivity, they have given themselves over to sensuality as to indulge in every kind of impurity, and they are full of greed. That, however, is not the way of life you learned when you heard about Christ and were taught in him in accordance with the truth that is in Jesus. You were taught with regard to your former way of life to put off the old self, which is being corrupted by its deceitful desires, and to be made new in the attitude of your minds. And to put on the new self, created to be like God in true righteousness and holiness. Stop. So, I hope you took some mental notes or even some physical notes, and we're going to go back and we're going to take this passage apart. And the reason we're going to take this passage apart is because there's some fundamental things that we need to grasp, we need to understand, we need to grasp and then put into practice in order for us to continue to move forward. And one of them, frankly, is an attitude. One of them is an attitude. Go back to verse 17 for a moment. And this is where we have to start being really careful about what we sense or think or feel when we read this passage. Look what it says. It says, "So I tell you this and insist on the Lord that you must no longer live as the Gentiles do and the futility of their thinking." Stop. I want you to grab what that statement is saying to you. How you feel about it when you see it. What you're thinking. Because here's what's interesting. If at least in my mind, as I read it, what I have to be careful of is not allowing my attitude to become an us versus them. Because look at the way this is written. If we're not careful, we can forget something very important. I tell you this and insist on the Lord that you must no longer live as those Gentiles do in the futility of their thinking. And that can become quite accusatory. It almost automatically creates a separation between us and them. And to some degree, there's already a separation between us and them. We are children of God, and at least right now, they're not. And so we have to also be careful that when we look at them, we don't think of ourselves as being better than them. This is a tough call. So we need to go back, and we need to look at a verse, okay? Do me a favor, go back two chapters, Ephesians chapter 2, verse 1, because we're going to look at what Paul writes in this chapter to remind us not to become haughty, to be very careful about how we view ourselves in light of God, especially in comparison to others. You ready? "As for you," who? The recipients. Who are the recipients? Christians. So we can say that's to us, right? "As for you, you were what? You were dead in your transgressions." Oh, what's Paul doing here? He's reminding us where we came from. He's reminding us that it's only by God's mercy and God's grace and Jesus, the work that Jesus did in reference to that mercy and grace, that gives us any position in Christ Jesus, that gives us any position in God. So he's reminding us where we come from. Now remember, Ephesians 1 speaks of the gloriousness with which God did his work and does his work in us and who we are now in him, that we are children of God with the Holy Spirit in us, as a deposit guaranteeing our inheritance. And so there's, you know, it's almost like he's saying, but don't forget. Look what it says. "As for you, you were dead in your transgressions and sins in which you used to live." You used to be there too. "When you followed the ways of the world and the ruler of the kingdom of the air." Who's he talking about, these Gentiles, within the futility of their thinking? He's talking about what we used to be, who we used to be among, those who are what? Under the ruler of the kingdom of the air. "The spirit who is now at work in those who are disobedient." Look at verse 3. "All of us lived among them at one time, gratifying the cravings of the flesh and following its desires and thoughts. And like the rest, we were by nature deserving of wrath." So what do we need to see when we're reading this part of Ephesians chapter 4? Don't forget from where you come. Don't. Do not let this separate you from the world in the sense that you would look down on and remove yourself from the people of the world. Don't judge them. Don't condemn them. Don't mock them. And in fact, be among them. Be among them in such a way as to bring Christ Jesus to them, just the way someone came into your life while you were in that exact same state and did the same for you. Have compassion. See, if we continue on in Ephesians 14, beginning at verse 17, if we continue on with any sense of contempt, with any sense of discompassionate heart, we have missed the point of the text. And we have missed the point of why we're still here. And this ought to actually produce in us compassion. So, go back to chapter 4 with me if you would. Remembering where it is we came from, Paul now speaks to how we must live. and that we can no longer live the way we used to live. Look what it says. As a prisoner for the Lord, then I urge you to live a life worthy of the calling you received. Now go down to verse 17 again, because we have received this incredible calling. He's going to teach us how to do this. Verse 17. So I tell you this and insist on the Lord, that you must no longer live as the Gentiles do, in the futility of their thinking. So we're going to stop there, and I need you to grab your notes, because we're going to go right down the notes today, because there's a lot of like technical stuff that I want to look at today. So we must no longer live as the Gentiles do in the futility of their thinking. Well, what is futility? Look at your notes with me, if you would. It means emptiness, vanity. Now, the word vanity has much in it. The first thing we see in vanity is emptiness, unreality. They don't get the reality of the situation. They feel purposeless. Their thinking is ineffective, it's unstable, it's frail, and they're drawn to worship things other than God. That's what happens with the futile mind. The second thing it does is it perverts the truth. The futile mind perverts the truth. Look what it says here. Contrary to what is regarded as normal or reasonable, their thinking is outside the norm, often for reasons that seem unaccountable or self-defeating. Even when there's just no way for them to have credibility in what they're thinking or doing, even when it defeats themselves, they continue to think the way they do. Stay with me now. And then it has the idea of deprivation or depravity. The state of fact of being futile, worthless, empty of significance, and at the same time having this great self-importance, conceit, and arrogance. This is pretty crazy. But that's exactly what the futile mind is. So we go on. Now there's a paragraph below, and what I did was we take the essence of the definition of futility in the original language, and I've written it out. Futile thinking then has in it the following: that without the ability to reason and seeing little, if any, purpose beyond the here and now, these people defeat themselves. And at the same time, they see themselves as important, and in so arrogantly insist, even if one believes that God is, that they do not need God. And this is to their demise, even their death. They are unable to see the truth and the reality of the truth. Now, we're going to come back to this definition later, but we're going to keep moving for now. So follow with me again. So go back to the text. So I tell you this in the Lord, insist on it. I tell you this and insist on it in the Lord, that you must no longer live as the Gentiles do in the futility of their thinking. They are, look at verse 18 now. They are darkened in their understanding. They are darkened in their understanding, blinded to the truth, and separated from the life of God. They're separated from life in God. Well, what does that mean? It means that Christ being the light and life of men, they have no connection to him. And so although they have life in them, as in they're animated, walking around, breathing, able to think and feel, what they do not have is the vigorous life of the Holy Spirit that engages them to their Creator. And so life, the true life, does not exist in them. And now because they're darkened in their mind, they can't even comprehend what that life looks like. I don't know how many of you were saved later in life. You know, if you're saved as a child, it's difficult for us to grasp this sometimes. But those of us who were saved later in life, I can go back and put myself in a position when I was 17, 18, 19 years old and living my life the way my body just desired to live its life, thinking that everything I was doing was, for the most part, perfectly fine, and then wondering why my life was falling apart at the seams. Even though I might appear to be successful in many ways, from the inside out, I'm falling apart. And I could not figure out why I could not engage with God as hard as I would try. Does this make sense? Well, this is the life of the one with the futile mind. This is the life of the one who cannot see beyond their sensuality. And understand that sensuality is not merely sexuality. Sensuality is living by the senses, by the flesh, by the desires. In other words, there's nothing that exists outside of my nerve endings. And so everything that I look for, everything that my body desires, I reach for. And that's a natural state. I mean, think about it in the most base senses. If I've got to go to the bathroom, I automatically get up and move to another room. If I'm hungry, I don't even think about it. I just reach out to the fridge. If I'm thirsty, I go over and I turn on the faucet. I don't even think twice about it. If my eyes see something that I desire, my body, my eyes turn my head turns my body, and my body moves. And I begin to go after the very thing that I wanted. That's what it looks like when we have a futile mind in regard to allowing the flesh to dominate the manner in which I go and the way that I go. Because I have no other life in me to counteract it. Is this making sense so far? So, it says, so I tell you this, and I insist on the Lord, that you must no longer live as the Gentiles do in the futility of their thinking. Now, there's that phrase is really important. What does it say? It says that you must no longer live as the Gentiles do in the futility of their thinking. Why did he put those two statements together? No longer live as the Gentiles live, which connotates how they live, what they do, and in the futility of their thinking. You know why he had to link those two things together? What you think is what you do. What dominates your heart and mind is what moves the body to go. You will live the way you think, and you will think what you believe. And if you believe that your flesh is all there is, if that's what you believe, your thought life will follow suit. And as long as your thought life follows suit, your brain will strategize to get whatever it is your body desires, and your behavior will follow. And there is your life. And so God is saying there's a new way, and there's a different way. And you are no longer living in the futility of your thinking. You now have a new way of thinking. And that's what we're here to develop. So we go on. So I tell you this, and insist on the Lord, that you must no longer live as the Gentiles do in the futility of their thinking. They are darkened in their understanding. They're blind to wisdom. They're blind to understanding anything other than what they're connected to physically and emotionally. And they're separated from the life of God because of the ignorance. Because of what? Because of the ignorance that is in them due to the hardening of their hearts. Now, what is the hardening of the heart? The hardening of the heart is callous. In other words, when the heart begins, have you ever had somebody in your life who has hurt you enough times that your heart begins to callous toward them? In other words, you lack feeling for them, and part of that is a protection. It's like a defense mechanism so that they can't hurt you any longer. Anybody ever been there? All right, okay. Well, that's the hardening of the heart. It's the callousing of the heart. But in this case, it's not necessarily toward an individual, where there might actually be some valid reasons to say, you know what, I'm going to hold you at arm's length because whatever it is between us, it's not very healthy and it hurts every time I'm with you. And so, But what that is a tiny demonstration of the truth of the spiritual world. And the idea that a heart can be so calloused as to not be able to receive from God that which God offers and not even be able to sense it any longer. Because not only is it callous in that it becomes hard, it also becomes unfeeling. In other words, it comes to a point where it cannot receive. It cannot, the love expressed to it cannot be received. And that's what's happening in the hearts of those who, in the futility of their mind, allow their hearts to continue to harden toward God, toward the life that God offers. Now, there's a very real world around us in this particular neighborhood. And there are occasions that I have to talk to young people who are doing things that they can't do if their heart isn't hard. And so when I sit down with one of these young people, and we sit down, the first thing I see is the hardness of their heart, that they're holding everything in arm's length as to not feel. It takes a little while to get a little glimpse into the flesh of the heart to be able to get them to even engage. And what they'll tell you in the midst of the conversation, as they begin to let their guard down just slightly, that in order for them to do what they do, their hearts have to be hard. They can't feel anything. It's like our whole world is having heroin injected right into it. And every young person that I talk to on the streets in that condition are a microcosm of that macrocosm, literally pumping heroin into their system so to further the lack of feeling, to continue to harden their heart. And that, my friends, is the reality. That's the truth. And so what should happen then? As I have compassion for the one on the streets who, for whatever reason, cannot face the reality of the reality of the day, because reality is always what? Painful. In order for them not to feel the pain, they inject something into them to not have to feel the pain. That should bring compassion. Well, so it is with the lost world. As long as their heart has continued to harden and they remain ignorant to the truth of God's love for them, that they were not just evolved from some ooze, that they were not formerly a monkey, that they were actually created in the image of God for the purpose of having a relationship with God, that God loved them so much that he would give his son for the sake of that relationship and call them by name as to draw them into that relationship and then embed his spirit that we would be part of that relationship. If you don't know that truth, you don't know the reality of God and what God's intentions are for you, and so everything else becomes your reality. Does that make sense? And that is the futile mind of the world. And if that doesn't bring us to tears of compassion for the lost, then we have forgotten from what we've been saved, and that our hearts were hard and we were ignorant once too. And the more we work out the futility of our own minds, the more compassion we will feel, because we become more like Christ, and our God weeps for his world. So we as believers have to be careful not to drug ourselves with the things of this world, to harden our own hearts from the pain of what it is to be a believer and to see the lost dying. And we need to have the courage to strip it back and say, okay, Jesus, change my mind and change my heart. Does this make sense? And that's the essence of what is being spoken here, which is why it cannot ever cause us to have an attitude of us versus them. But Father, how do you lead me to them? And how do you clear my mind to use me to help clear their mind, to bring softness to that heart. So, forgive me for a moment. Sorry about that.
So we're in verse 18.
I need to pray. Ken? Kenny, would you pray, please? Okay, I know you couldn't all hear that, but thank you for bearing with it. Okay, so here we go. We're in verse 18 again. It says, they are darkened in their understanding and separated from the life of God because of the ignorance that is in them due to the hardening of their hearts. So here, look at your notes with me for a moment. They are now still darkened and blinded now to their understanding and separated from the life of God. And this because of the ignorance that is in them due to the callousing and the numbness of their hearts. They are darkened and blind in their understanding and their ability to reason or thoroughly think critically to come to a balanced conclusion. They can't see the truth, and so they can't balance the truth. Their reality is what they feel. if you, that little paragraph, if you look at it with me, and there's a key term there, and I embolden it in your notes. It says, to use the mind properly, being able to move from one side of an issue to the other to reach balanced conclusions. In other words, not being so dominated by one aspect of who you are or your life that you can actually, when you see an issue, you can use both sides of your mind to toss it back and forth as to gain wisdom and understanding. In other words, having two tools and not just one to discern. Okay, so look what it says next. This gives us a full orbed reasoning. In other words, we're able to use both orbs of our mind. We're able to use both how God has created us and how then he's saved us and recreated us. So this kind of thinking literally reaches across the other side of the matter. Now, let me give you if you're in politics, please forgive me, and I think Judge Spahn just left so I can say this. Okay, so here's the deal. You want a good, tangible, real-life look at what it means to not be able to use both orbs to get a full orb view? How many of us are thrilled with the way Congress has behaved themselves over the last, 40 years? Anybody? The difficulty we have between liberals and conservatives in the Congress trying in any way, shape, or form to come to a conclusion on anything that would help anyone do anything for any purpose, okay, is a beautiful example, unfortunately, of futility. The fact of the matter is that for our government to actually function well, we need both liberals and conservatives. And for us who might not understand that, let me at least put it in this sense. We need the passion and the vision and the heartache of the liberal. And we need the structure and the wisdom and the guidance of the conservative. And the two of them must learn to compromise and come together to build structures that accomplish both ends. So it is in our minds. And so it is with Christ Jesus. We need both. We need wisdom and we need spirit. We need truth and we need love. He has beautifully created us in his image as a physical and spiritual being. And then he has blessed us with his presence and empowered us with the truth of his word by the Holy Spirit. We need both. That is what that's what breaks futility apart. Does that make sense? Okay, so we go on. So they are separated or excluded from the life of God because of the ignorance that is in them, and because of this, and that is because of the hardness of their heart. Now, go to verse 19, if you would. Now it gets even tougher, because he begins to describe it even more thoroughly. It says, having lost all sensitivity. Having lost what? All sensitivity. Now so callous. Now, I'll give you another example. Anybody here ever been a guitarist or a bass player? You know what it's like to, when you build your calluses on your left hand to be able to play chords, it's really cool because not only can you play the guitar, but you can actually turn bacon with the tips of your fingers and you wouldn't even know it. The thing I missed most about quitting guitar about 10 years ago is I have to use a fork to flip my bacon because my calluses are gone. All right, so here's the deal. What happened to my fingertips is I lost my sensitivity when it was calloused. And that's what we're speaking of here. The sensitivity, the heart is gone. And the reason is because the heart has become hard. And the reason the heart has become hard is because they're ignorant of the truth. And the truth is that God loves them, but they can't take that. They don't understand it. They can't grasp it. That's why it's so essential that we bring it. And it's so essential that in order for us to, we need to understand this, in order for us to bring it the way it needs to be brought, or brung, depending on where you're from, in order for us to bring it, we have to be sensitive to him. We have to eliminate continually, progressively, whatever futility continues to exist in us. Remembering that sanctification is progressive. Being persuaded of the truth is progressive. Our growing into the likeness of Christ is progressive, and it'll happen for the rest of eternity as we shed everything that is human and gain everything that is God. So we read on. having lost all sensitivity, they now, because they lack sensitivity, they have given themselves over. Now, look at the way that is said. It's really important, again, to breed compassion. Look what it says. Having lost all sensitivity, they have given themselves over to sensuality, the senses, as to indulge in every kind of impurity, and they are full of greed. And what they mean by greed there is their need for more and more. The body, the flesh, is never, ever satiated. It is never satisfied. It will always want more. Always. And so all of this, the ignorance and the hardening produces an insensitivity. That insensitivity allows them to be given over to sensuality, is to indulge in every kind of impurity with a greater desire for more. Because that's feeding them. That's their food. You know what it says about pastors? You know, we just came out of the passage, we didn't read it, but we just came out of the passage right before this that says that a pastor's job is to make sure that you guys are well fed. I combine Luke 12 and Ephesians 4, and my job as the pastor here, and anybody who teaches, our job is to be a chef and to prepare a meal for you that is edible and is palatable and is nutritious and allows you to go. The reason is because by nature we'll eat anything the world will offer us and we'll gorge ourselves on it. The problem is those are empty calories. It's processed food and sugar and everything you can imagine. If I don't give you meat and potatoes and vegetables during the week, man, you're going to, you know, we just eat donuts all week long. And we just continue. And is the body ever satisfied with one donut? Yeah. I don't eat donuts anymore because my body's insatiable. But I eat Lay's potato chips. And remember the old commercial? You can't eat just one. I can't eat just 1 pound. My wife and I we just made a pact that I'm not allowed to touch a bag of Lay's potato chips after 7 o'clock at night, because I'll eat the whole stinking pound in one sitting. That's what your flesh wants. That's what it wants. Lay's potato chips. Not roughly. Regular old Lay's potato. No flavors. Lay's potato chips. Well, here's the deal. The flesh never stops consuming. And the desire is never satisfied. That's why we need to feed ourselves spiritually to work up muscle, that we don't crave the garbage of the world, but in fact we are wonderfully, you know, wonderfully fed by what God has for us, and our body is a living, breathing organism that is getting great nutrition and building itself up in strength and stamina. Does this make sense? So that's what it is. So, reading your notes with actually, if you're on the YouTube version thing, you'll be able to follow me. Otherwise, just listen closely. Close your eyes if you want. Look out the window. Look at my shirt. Do whatever you need to do. All right. Having lost all sensitivity, having become callous and past feeling, they've given themselves over to sensuality, carnality, living for the flesh, so as to indulge in every kind of impurity, and the greed. They're full of greed and a desire to have more and more. But in Christ, we can only, but before Christ, we could only think from that perspective, the perspective of the flesh. But now, here's the transformation, here's the transition. You ready for this? But now we have the mind of Christ, which enables us to see both sides of an issue. We have in us now the mind of Christ and the Holy Spirit, which means we have in us the wisdom of Christ in right thinking. How we view life and sin and our ability and responsibility to weigh out our decisions based on our access to truth and our ability to ascertain and extrapolate truth, to live it out, and what is right and just and fair. Here's the difference. At one time, we were created as a soul that happens to reside in a body. But when sin overwhelmed us, it made us think that we're our body that just happens to contain a soul. Does that make sense? And as long as we think we're a body that just happens to contain a soul, we've lost our reality. Because the reality is that we're spiritual beings. That our soul is the essence of who we are. It's our life. And the Spirit has engaged the soul as to ignite that life. And our body is the container in which it resides. As long as we have that backwards, we continue to live for the body, and the soul just happens to animate it. So it's absolutely essential. The futility of our thinking is that we would remain in this idea that my body is me, and my soul just happens to reside there, and therefore I'm a slave to my body. Put in your notes here Romans chapter 7 and 8. But that's not who I am. The reality is, the truth is, when my futile mind is now made unreprobate, it's made in a way that I now can think, this is what I discover that I am. I am a soul that happens to reside in a body. And I am, as the Spirit enlivens and strengthens my soul, and the Word of God illumines the path in front of me, you know what I'm to do? I'm to take my body and make it my slave. So that my body doesn't do whatever it wants to do. But it does what the Holy Spirit in me wants to do as I engage with Him in the truth with my soul. Does this make sense? And that's the reversal of the futile mind. That is the reversal of the futile mind. So we go on. So now we have the mind of Christ and the Holy Spirit, which means we have in us the wisdom of Christ. Now, this is what I need you to do. I'm going to show you what this said. I'm not going to elaborate on this passage, I promise, because if we do, we'll be here for another however long it takes, and it'll take a long time, and we don't have that kind of time. So go to 1 Corinthians 2, and we're going to start at verse 6. 1 Corinthians 2, 6. And I think the Word and the Holy Spirit teaching us the Word, walking us through the Word, will give us a great handle on what it is that we're just saying. You ready? So in 1 Corinthians, go back a couple of books, 1 Corinthians chapter 2, starting at verse 6. I'm so sad we're not going to get through all this. Ready? Here we go. It says, we do, however, speak a message of wisdom among the mature, but not the wisdom of this age, which would be futile wisdom, or of the rulers of this age, which would be Satan himself, who are coming to nothing. Their lives are futile. No, we declare God's wisdom, a mystery that has been hidden and that God destined for our glory before time began. None of the rulers of this age understood it, for if they had, they would not have crucified the Lord of glory in their futile thinking. However, as it is written, what no eye has seen, what no ear has heard, and what no human mind has conceived, the things God has prepared for those who love him. That's the new truth, actually an ancient truth that has now been revealed to us. These are the things God has revealed to us by His Spirit. The Spirit searches all things, even the deep things of God. For who knows a person's thoughts except their own spirit within them? In the same way, no one knows the thoughts of God except the Spirit of God. What we have received is not the spirit of the world. We already had that. But the Spirit who is from God, who now does what? Reveals to us the reality, which is the spiritual reality in Christ Jesus, so that we might understand what God has freely given us. In other words, we couldn't understand God or anything that He would give us. We couldn't grasp it. But now that we have the mind of Christ and the Holy Spirit, because of the work God has done, we now can receive it and understand it because we have been given the mind of Christ. So this is what we speak, not in words taught to us by human wisdom, futility, but in words taught by the Spirit, actual wisdom, explaining spiritual, what's that next word? Explaining spiritual what? Realities. See, we have this idea that on the earth, all this physical stuff is the reality, when in fact, it's only half the reality. And when your reality is absolutely encompassed by only one side of the truth, you become futile. So we have an entire world who's living in the flesh's reality without any understanding of the true reality of God and His love for us and His desire for us as children to draw us to Himself and what it is done to gain that and then the kind of relationship He wants to have with us. The very Creator God wanting to have relationship with His creation. That's the reality. And once you grasp and understand that reality, you're no longer futile. Does that make sense? So, the person, how does he put it? Look what it says. The person without the Spirit does not accept the things that come from the Spirit of God, but considers them what? Foolishness. And cannot understand them because they are discerned only through the Spirit. The person with the Spirit makes judgments about all things. Why can we make judgments about all things? The world can only judge about fleshy things, about worldly things. Why can we make judgments about everything? Because we have the Spirit of God in us. We have both. We understand both realities. We exist here on earth, so we understand the flesh and we understand the world. But we also now have the mind of God that enables us to understand the heavenlies and the spiritual and our Father and our position in Him. And now we're able to look at a situation and judge it wisely because we can see both sides of the issue. What did we say in the definition of futility? That they are unable to go from one side to the other because they only know one side. And when you gain the knowledge of Christ, you now have a fully orbed understanding, which means you're able to ascertain all things. That's what the mind of Christ does for us. We are no longer futile. We're no longer trapped in our flesh. We neither have to be a slave to this world, our desires, or our passions. But in fact, now we rule over them by the power of the Spirit and the truth of God. So let's finish this up. The person with the Spirit makes judgments about all things, but such a person is not subject to merely human judgments. Well, why? Because they're futile. Who has known the mind of the Lord so as to instruct him? What person of the world has been able to say, okay, this is God's mind, I'm going to tell him how to do it? Nobody. So look what it says next. But we have what? The mind of God. That's crazy. That's wisdom, that's light, and that's life. And what is Jesus? Wisdom, light, and life. And what is the Holy Spirit? Wisdom, light, and life. And what is his word? Wisdom, light, and life. So, I'm going to at least, if we may, read the next paragraph with me in the notes, if you would. It says, because our thinking, I think it's there, because our thinking used to be futile, is that in your notes? It will be in the electronic, I don't know if it'll be physical, but I'll read on. Certainly we now have to train ourselves and practice such things as our minds to some degree have had a mind of their own and therefore have had their own way or ways of doing things that must be intentionally changed. Be made new in the attitude of your minds is the command. We are to be regularly convinced or persuaded of the truth as to combat and replace the lies that we had previously believed and lived out. So we now are being transformed into the likeness of Christ. But we join the transformation in our sanctification by grabbing every futile thought, every futile behavior, every act of futility, and we take the mind of Christ and we compare it to the truth, and we throw it down. We throw it down. So, two things, and we can't go. I'll read the text. We got to scoot. What a bummer. Last night I got through everything. I didn't cry last night, though, so that you guys got bonus tears for whatever reason. I apologize for that. But all the notes are here, so you can take this home and you can walk right through this. There are a bazillion verses here to guide you every step of the way in this. I did not want to leave you wanting. Okay, so go back to Ephesians 4 real quick. Verse 20. Because this is the encouragement. You ready? That, however, is not the way of life you learned, this life of futility. When you heard about Christ and were taught in him in accordance with the truth that is in Jesus, you were taught with regard to the former way of life to put off the old self, not to conceal it, not to suppress it, not to hide it, but to take it off. Let me give you an example. You ever, think about something you did when you were younger and it was wrong and you're kind of ashamed to admit that you did it, but for whatever reason you refuse to release it. You just kind of hold on to it and you kind of put it back here and hide it in case you want to take it back out and look at it again. Anybody? Maybe I'm the only idiot here. Okay, all right, that's okay. That's what we do when we refuse to take something off and we decide just to hide it somewhere. The idea is to remove it, to see it, allow the truth to reveal it, allow the Spirit to help us work it out, remove it from ourselves, and then replace it with something new. So look what it says. We're to take off, put off the old self, which is being corrupted by its deceitful desires, to be made new in the attitude of our minds, and to do what? Put on the new self, created to be like God in true righteousness and holiness. Taking that thing that is no longer like Jesus off, as it was revealed to us. Because God, by God's grace and faithfulness, he reveals those things as our faith can handle it, that is not like Jesus. And he says, let me help you remove that. But in the removal, we must replace it. Don't leave ourselves naked. But in fact, put on now the clean shirt of righteousness. That's the word picture. So, what do I do? There are two things, and we can't go there. Hopefully it's in your notes. Hopefully I get through it at 11. You can take a peek at that one. Certainly it's on the podcast from last night. Your notes will guide you through it. But let me encourage you with this. There are two things that we need to recognize in order to do this that removes futility. One is that we fear and reverent awe of the Lord God. And in that, we gain knowledge and wisdom. And the first bit of knowledge and wisdom is when we recognize our own poverty. Blessed are you who are poor in spirit, who bring nothing to the party. Because the moment those two things happen, we must surrender. We must. God, you are God and you are almighty. And I see in reference to you that I am nothing and I bring nothing and I need you. And futility is gone. Futility dissipates. So if you go to the back part of your page, we're not going to look at the text, but I want to at least walk you through this very quickly. Band, go ahead and get in place if you would, please. So what principles and practices or skills do we use to do this? We want to renew our mind. We want to renew our mind in the word and in prayer, allowing our attitude to be transformed. We need to be aware of the battle that's within us and acknowledge the truth of it. Taking every thought, taking every attitude, taking every false belief or lie captive and make it obedient. Compare it to the truth and make it obedient to Christ. Taking it off and putting on the new. When that happens, in the middle of that battle, we need to believe the truth that that battle is not one of flesh, but of mind and spirit. That the weapons that are available to us and are useful, and that as we battle, we allow our thoughts to be examined by the truth and bring them into line to Christ. That's the encouragement. And he has given us everything we need to be able to do that. And that's how we begin to dismantle futility. That's how we take every futile thought that we have, every futile feeling that we have, every futile desire that we have, and we allow it to be dismantled in front of us, removed, and then we take the truth and replace it and put it on new. Amen? Amen. Let's stand and sing.
Passion, I was made to be a man.
see you. I see a pure spotless bride. She is a city that shines.
Father, we thank you so much for not only saving us, but also giving us your mind. That to some degree, we don't have to wait till we get to heaven to engage with you, because you do it here and you reveal truth and reality to us. The reality that we are have been created in your image by a personal, wonderful creator God who has crafted each one of us uniquely and distinctly and personally. That you call us by name and you long to know us. And you weep for those with hardened and callous hearts. You weep for those who are dying in their ignorance. You weep for those who are living in their sensuality. May we seek you with our whole heart. May we know you better and better. May we present to you the parts of us that don't resemble you as you reveal them, may we hand them over. So help us take them off and put them down and replace it with truth and replace it with integrity and replace it with character and replace it with compassion. Thank you, Jesus. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Now, the second announcement that I did not get to share yet is sometimes in the futility of our remaining futility of our minds, we have this idea that we can do Christianity on our own. And for some of us, this larger body is a wonderful opportunity for us to fellowship and be together. And for others of us, there's a need for us to connect in a closer and smaller way. If you feel at all led to be part of a small group, I would encourage you strongly to be here this evening to get information on the small groups that are beginning. It'll be downstairs, I believe at 7 o'clock, Matt. Is that the right time? I think it's 7 o'clock. It's in your bulletin regardless. But I would encourage you strongly to be a part of that and look into it and continue to walk into the likeness of Christ with one another, because this is not to be done alone, my friends. This is to be done with each other. Have a wonderful week, guys, and enjoy the Bills game if you get to watch it.